Here are my predictions. Generative AI is going to try to pretty much take everything, media, concepts, whatever that exists that can be generated online will basically be generated through AI. So what do? We have to figure out ways to have ownership in these companies, at least the ones that are going to be AI enabled. We want to have ability to create our own AI systems, our own agentic systems, right? And the last thing I'm looking at is APIs. CEOs of these AI companies are making huge changes in 2025. As a matter of fact, the next 3 years up to 2028 is going to be pivotal. Now, they're going to make big economic changes. There's going to be technological changes that we're going to talk about today.
In 2025, we will have systems that people look at, even people who are skeptical of current progress, and say, wow, that, I did not expect that.
But also, what are the changes to people, human labor, us? And I'm going to show you exactly what the plan is. Number one, generative AI on everything. The goal here is they're not just looking at AI or even AGI, but ASI, as Google put out. But generative everything means on your phone, you may have an app. Apple, on the other hand, could say, screw all that. We don't want it anymore. What we will do is have generative apps on our phones. We could basically have everyone just generate whatever they want based on a question they ask, and they'll get the Google-like view. So instead of having Google or YouTube installed on your phone, you will just have a question, and it would simulate a Google-like environment or a Google-like app for you in real time, and you can watch the video based on some API connection or some other source of data that I can pull from. The whole thing here is we're moving into an era of generative everything, which means any media online can be generated versus being created by some individual, which is really difficult for someone who's a software engineer or a content creator or any kind of media in some sense, if anything that's online or digital can be done by an AI. So number two, compute versus labor. I mentioned this before in a different video. You can see here, where we talk about how NVIDIA GPUs are used to compute. But remember, those computations are turned into tasks. As Sam Altman has said, we're not looking at jobs or job titles, we're looking at tasks. But the issue is, as more compute comes online, that has the potential to take over positions and labor and jobs. And as there are more compute, and you got to think about the cost analysis here, and as I mentioned in a different video, there's cost analysis where as the prices of compute comes down, CEOs can't tell the shareholders we can't move to compute or, you know, move out people to replace them with compute because that won't be in the interest of shareholders, which is a little bit of a paradox, right? Now they have to remove people out, put in compute, because they know that that will save them money and time and increase productivity, which is quite a revelation in some people's eyes. It hasn't happened yet, but you'll see that in a slow migration over time. Even I've been told by my cousin, you know, I didn't notice this too recently, that some of the different restaurants are putting out these AI machines are at the front where you talk to it versus a person. That's over, I think, at Taco Bell or something like that. So between 2022 to 2025, in 3 years, we've seen significant growth of GPT 3.5, 4. We've seen it grow to 0.1 to even 0.3 by the end of the year, reaching near the ARC level of, 85% minimum, which is something that was significant. Now, they had, you know, did a lot of computation to get to that point, but they were easily able to train it to basically human-level cognitive performance. What that mean here is, if you're looking at that past and say, okay, let's look at the trajectory of the future, where now we've used traditional, you know, data centers, going to switch to using nuclear power, right? Which is going to be a big difference. Why is that? Nuclear power is consistently and keeps going and allows you to train these very, very sophisticated, high complex, possibly 400 billion parameter models to who knows, we may move into the trillion parameter model, which is a level of complexity we haven't seen yet. Number three, AI frameworks. We've seen over the past couple of years, these AI frameworks have been, you know, instrumental in having people develop companies and build them out. But if you remember back at the dot-com bubble, right, there was a lot of websites, all of them doing different things because they, you know, they didn't really do anything because at the time they weren't in 2.0, they were just 1.0 websites, and they made money at the time. But after the bubble popped, people came to realization only certain things were needed, right? Even Amazon had a hard time, but they were able to get through it because their moat was real. And these companies were building all these tools. I get it. They have a great point now because the market's up and things are looking pretty well. But don't get yourself fixed into a framework because the evolution of AI is changing faster than what you can even try to build. So in my opinion, at least that I would think, build the absolute tool you need. And the LLMs, not that you want to become reliant on those, but they're going to try to eat into the businesses who are working on these individual tools. I'm not going to name any here because I don't want to draw out certain companies. But what I'm getting at is, if you think about an AI framework, I'm sure you've used a few. And you're thinking, what is it about this framework? Would it last in the next, you know, 2 years? Probably not. I give it 6 months, maybe a year. But it's going to be a lot of evolution that's going to over make that framework seem useless because they're going to be basically baked into the other applications. For example, think about Claude, computer use, right? All these agentic products that came out beforehand who were saying, hey, you can do search on this, you can do all this stuff like this. Claude came out and says, hey, we can do it too. And guess what? So it can open AI. And guess what? The more and more that people try to work on, more and more these tools come out. So this is going to be a challenge. So this is where I would definitely say, don't use frameworks. And I'll explain in a moment what actually will work. Number four, income will become not like the 9-to-5 job. There will be two types of income. Transactional, which as we mentioned earlier about task. And number two, equity. Now, equity is a passive thing that people think about now, right? Everyone has, you know, maybe you invested in some random company and blah, blah, blah. And these are passive functions in our society now. I think that's going to be pulled up and pushed into the front seat for a lot of people because the way society is going to work, it's going to be hard to make money through traditional means of today's time, which is going out, doing some labor, you know, for some period of time, and then that's it. I think the transformation is going to be where you'll spend more time with your equity, and that equity in that company will continue to grow because it's based on the number of transactions that the AIs are doing, right? So, and I'm not trying to say you should invest in companies. I'm not trying to get into that. But here's what I want to get into. The Mag 7 at this moment, now things could change in the future, but at this moment, the Mag 7, Apple, Google, NVIDIA, Tesla, Microsoft, am I missing one? Amazon. Anyway, basically, those Mag 7 companies make up about 35% of the entire S&P 500. Given this 500 companies, these seven make up 35% as of this year. Now, who knows what that would be in the future? And I'm not trying to go into investments and nothing like that. But what I'm trying to get at is it's because they were AI. They were AI enabled and they were focusing on making the productivity higher. Now, some may say, Frank, hey, hold out, pump the brakes. This could be a bubble. This is, you know, a lot of people think this is not real. And AI just seems a lot of, very fake. Or it's just, you know, it's not big as what people are making it. I can understand that. But the trajectory of this is growing faster than what we have. If it just stopped today, I can understand that. But I don't see the intentions of these CEOs stopping. They are working to ASI and they're all competing against each other, including other countries as well. Like, for example, the whole product came out recently of DeepSeek. What I'm getting at is it's not just the Mag 7 in the United States, but it's a global system of everyone trying to build the most complex AI systems that can do whatever, because whoever reached this, you know, AGI, as I said some years ago, or whoever reached ASI, we're going to see a huge shift in how the society runs. I think that we should be focused on making sure that we build, you know, quality, useful AI. But what does that mean for everyone else? It means that as they're trying to build these very complex, very high systems, they're fighting against each other because basically supremacy is based on who has the best systems. But they're kind of like, it's a race to the bottom for them. For us, we all get impacted by this because it ends up rendering people who do work somewhat useless. So I'll talk about that in a moment, but I'm going to get into trying to set the stage. What is that, or what does that mean for the generic public when these companies are building these highly sophisticated tools that doesn't need people? You need people before to input data and collect your information. But once you have all of that, they can build these very advanced systems. Number five, the key to all of this, right, is ownership. Ownership in the AI, ownership in the companies, ownership in these agentic systems is super important. More important than a traditional job, in my opinion. I think jobs are important now. You know, it helps fund you. But what I'm getting at is, it's going to be imperative in the future, starting now, that we start thinking about where does these systems rely? Because the same capitalistic society that we have now is slightly evolving. It's not this traditional, you know, someone go works to make some money, you know, they try to scale it up and voila, everyone wins, ha ha ha, and then move on. We have these systems that are, you know, working and thinking and improving all behind the scenes. Basically, what we have is, say there's 8 billion people in the world now, right? With AI, we just made it 20 billion. Because we just increased the number of workers in some weird way to a higher amount. But what happens with, you know, supply and demand, as they're a higher supply and the demand is still low because there's still only 8 billion people on the planet, that means the price of everything comes down, which is good. But the price or labor of work is now reduced. And if we have, you know, all these AI agents doing all this work and they're not us, then that's where things become disgruntled. So we need to look at a big thing of basically ownership in the companies, ownership in the AI, and basically ownership in the process. Here's how I look at it. I have this graph here. You see the graph, there's four quadrants. Top quadrant is basically resources, the top left quadrant. The bottom right quadrant is labor. The right bottom quadrant is basically equity and equity assets. And the top right quadrant that I created is basically, you know, economic power. It's, for lack of a better word, it's basically power. And you say, okay, in these four different quadrants, you look at it and you say, okay, well, where do most people fit? Most people are in the left bottom quadrant, which is, you know, labor, right? This, you have your employee, you have your manager, consultants, CEOs, investors, hedge funds. These companies or these people are in this area, right? The blue line moving up. You see that trajectory there? Well, I realized that there is also a competing one. There is the actual orangey line I have here that mirrors us. And this is above us a little bit because they're closer to the resources than we are. But this is the automation. The automation comes up this line here, as you can see, and they are basically doing similar functions that we are. It's not fully baked in yet. If I was to show it now, it'll be spotty. It's like spotty little lines on there because yet they're not fully created. What these companies are doing, they're trying to create the same linear projection. This curve, this line, where they can see, hey, we're doing the full process of what all these people are doing and giving it to AI to do it all. Even Sam Altman said, hey, I'm going to let the AI determine how we make money. If you give all of this away to AI to do, that becomes, you know, challenging, and there's a lot of ethical issues with that, but we'll just leave it there for now. But just say that that line is where we have the new trajectory. So what does that mean? In order for us to still win in this process, is we need to have ownership of that line in some fraction. Now, you can't have ownership of all of it. I mean, it's very hard to do, but some ownership of that line. Meaning, hey, I built this product. This product does well. Here, how's it influences the economy or economic issues? Here's that. Or I own a company who's doing that. That company is doing this, and I ride that tailwind. So that's kind of what I'm looking at. It's looking at productivity as not a boring word, but look at productivity as a tool that helps you grow. Because really, at the end of the day, when you do our jobs and everything, how productive are we? It's going to be a word you're going to hear a lot. It's going to be a word you're going to hear a lot from everyone. Productivity, productivity, productivity. Why? Because behind the scenes, they're looking at AI as productivity. And they're going to try to measure that up against people. And you're going to hear that a lot. So what I'm trying to say is, productivity is a word that we should at least take in offense versus in defense. Offensively mean, what can I use at my advantage to make something productive that I own? That's very important. Number six, APIs. Why are APIs needed? I'll explain in a moment. Basically, AI systems or AGI systems are intelligent and very smart, but they need some kind of tools or connectors to help them get the data. Satya Nadella said that we're going to move away from apps. We're going to move away from these, GUIs or front ends, and all is going to reside back in the data layer. And that's a struggle, right? So if there's this, the app layer, and then down here you got the database layer, but you don't control that database layer. Well, at least you don't think so. How do you build from this? The API layer. At least until they try to figure that part out, that's kind of where we want to be. Developers want to be in the API layer. So I believe that 2025 is going to be a year of a lot of APIs, because people are thinking through, where do we fit? How do we sit in the future of this? And we know the aggressive growth of AI is going to try to push for eating up pretty much all the other services. That's why I said I think frameworks are not going to be great. I don't think, the whole concept of trying to build your own app, which could be useful, but has to be something staggeringly different that these other guys can't do or roll into their application. And the thing of this old adage or idea that people say that, hey, pick this one vertical that this other company can't do. And I agree with that for a short period of time, 6 months, a year maybe. But these AIs are going to try to, they're building in one vertical, but they're going to kind of spread out to all at some point. And you want to make sure that your moat's not within the grasp of what they're trying to grab. So recap, here are my predictions. Generative AI is going to try to pretty much take everything, media, concepts, whatever that exists that can be generated online will basically be generated through AI. How does that impact us? Economically changes the way we live. Economically changes the way we see things. Has impacts on capitalism. So what do? We have to figure out ways to have ownership in these companies, at least the ones that are going to be AI enabled. We want to have ability to create our own AI systems, our own agentic systems that support us and help us grow, multiply us multiple times, meaning that we're growing with systems that don't have just one version of me, but four or five versions of me at scale. Right. And the last thing I'm looking at is APIs. If you're a developer, or you're even someone who's not a developer, but you have access to data, or you have access to make data, APIs are a great point, because in the API layer, you're able to deliver as much data as you can to these AIs, where they still have to get that information from you. That is a layer they have to get past. So if you build that out and you have access to some information that you can either generate or create, and you're that one vertical, you'll be good in it and they'll love that. So here we are. It's going to be 2028 soon. What are you going to do?